Hi, everyone. I'm your host, Arlen Schumer, and welcome to one of my pop culture presentations. Get ready to be both educated and entertained, what I call edutainment. And when you're done, please be sure to click the subscribe or follow button on your platform screen to be notified of all of my upcoming pop culture presentations. If D.W. Griffith is considered the father of film for the many camera narrative techniques he pioneered, then Will Eisner should be considered the father of the comic book for the same reason. Heck, he even wrote the book on the subject. In fact, he wrote more than one book on the subject. Eisner was there at the dawn of the comic book industry, as well as that of the graphic novel, with a contract with God. And at the end of his career, had become the champion of the graphic novel, Will Eisner, whose very name is on the Academy Awards of the comic book industry. And tonight, on the 81st anniversary of the debut of his magnum opus, we're going to examine, extol, and enjoy the graphic greatness of Will Eisner's The Spirit. And my name is Arlen Schumer. Eisner's creation starts in 1940, not as an actual comic book, but as a seven-page comic book insert into newspapers, starting in 1940 and ending in 1952. Of course, that color art began as black and white artwork, which Eisner was a master of. And to really begin to investigate the spirit, the magnum opus of Will Eisner, we've got to look at the city, Central City, a fictitious name for what was essentially the New York, the Brooklyn that Eisner grew up in as a son of Jewish immigrants from Austria at the turn of the century. The tenements and the ghettos and the areas that Eisner lived in and grew up in, he would later funnel back to us through his artwork. And it was as a young man growing up, and his father, he had been a painter for Viennese palaces. And when he came to New York, the only work he could find was doing set designs, painted scenery for the Yiddish theater, which was bustling in the lower Second Avenue in the Lower East Side of New York City. The stories they would tell in the Yiddish theater were essentially the stories of themselves, the immigrants coming to a new world and bringing with them the ethics, the values, the ideals, the stories of the old world. Eisner, showing artistic talent, descended from his father, like a lot of young artists at the time, were into the burgeoning field of comic strips, which is where the money was to be made. And Eisner was no different, doing strips like Harry Carey. But you can see he's already in the, cops and robbers comic strip mold. But all of that would change in 1938 with the appearance of the first comic book issue of Superman Action Comics, created by Jerry Siegel and Joe Shuster. And he would kick off the superhero genre and the comic book field itself. And immediately, of course, Batman would follow. And an entire industry and genre were created overnight. And some of Eisner's earliest works, you can see, again, his both cartoony style and his realistic style kind of merging, which would become basically Eisner's graphic cartooning look. But in the late 30s, he's doing a lot of different adventure genres. The Hawk by by the way, look at the name, Willis Renzi. Now, like a lot of Jews in the early 20th century, in mid 20th century, they changed their names to fit in with Christian America. But this is the only time early on where Eisner would just change his name like that. Renzi, Eisner spelled backwards. But you can see how Eisner was influenced by, you know, the Hawks of the Sea and Errol Flynn movies of that 1930s period, the golden age of those kind of films. And with the budding of World War II, you know, he would eventually create the Blackhawks. But it's not really what kicked off his comic book career. It was the fact that right after Superman's created, he does Wonder Man, and DC Comics promptly sues, claiming infringement, that it too closely resembled Superman. And that soured Eisner on doing superhero genre comics. Here's a photograph of a New York City newsstand in the spring of 38, because look down below, there's that Action Comics. But the newspaper industry immediately felt the sting of the burgeoning field of comic books after Superman. So the Des Moines Register and Tribune approached Eisner and asked if he and his studio would create a 16-page comic book section that would be comic book size, but inserted into their newspapers. And Eisner jumped at the opportunity, but they wanted a superhero. And Eisner had just been soured on superheroes because of his litigation over Wonder Man and losing to DC Comics. So he decides to give them this character, the Spirit. Daredevil criminal. Oh, by the way, his only concession to the superhero genre, yeah, the mask. But as he's described here, daredevil criminologist engages in breathtaking battles with mighty gangs. The Spirit stars in one of the three complete stories every week in the Sunday Records new comic book section. And there is our 81 years ago on this date, on a Sunday, the very first appearance of the Spirit. And you can see this is Eisner's early style, much more cartoony, but also notice the in this first origin story, Eisner, the young Eisner is trying to be a little more realistic with that face in the center. But you can see he's already experimenting with different panel shapes. As we see what happens to Denny Colt, they think he's dead, but he's not dead. And here, last page of the story, Commissioner Dolan asks, and all kidding aside, what are you going to do, lad? Well, remain dead and take up the job of being the Spirit. You know, Dolan, there are criminals and crimes beyond the reach of police, but the Spirit can reach them. But how about food, money? Where will you live? In the cemetery. As for money, I'll collect the rewards. Oh, we Spirits get along fine. By the way, here's my card. And so began the 7-page stories that Eisner, and he had a studio of art assistants that we're going to discuss. But look at starting from the second installment. We already have Eisner breaking the panel borders graphically with this figure of the Spirit dangling from the limb. And then I think the following week, you get one of the first of what will be a graphic hallmark of the Spirit's visage with the city. From the beginning, Eisner's layout was, you know, no different really than what was happening in other comic art at the time by Bob Kane or by, you know, Joe Shuster in Superman. But right away, Eisner's breaking literally all the rules in panel and page layout and design, and experimenting with, you know, different typography. You can see the lettering is very designed and very graphic. And even the little hint of music in the upper left corner that we're going to talk about, this page itself is Eisner talking about the musicality, the choreography of comic book heroics. Now, the only other artist at this time that's breaking panel borders is probably the early Jack Kirby, who with Joe Simon, his partner, was doing Captain America at the time with, you know, panel breakings like this. But it was really on the page one, the splash page, as it's called in comic book terms, which was the first page when you'd open up the cover. But of course, the Spirit's first page had to function also as the cover of the comic book section, of which the Spirit was the first seven pages. And you can see how he's, you know, almost immediately is experimenting with incorporating the Spirit logo itself into the graphic design and the narrative itself. Another early example, March of 1941. But it was this rethinking of the splash page itself, this kind of meta level of the splash page, the cover being part and parcel of the narrative itself. And Eisner, as a true artist, looking at his medium and having a meta quality, so that it is a comic book insert into a newspaper that looks like a newspaper that talks about who the Spirit is, and the Spirit himself is reading the newspaper in the illustration. Well, speaking of newspapers, after this headline hit, Eisner, like many of his peers, went into World War II. And his experiences there, of course, affected him, like every veteran. But then when the war was done, Eisner, by the way, while he was gone, his assistants and other artists were maintaining the Spirit on a weekly basis. But when Eisner comes back from the war in 45 and starts doing the Spirit again, as we kick off 1946, I believe he was no different than any of the other creative, artistic veterans who, in the case of J.D. Salinger, were only learning now, recently, the last couple of years, about how what he must have had as post-traumatic stress disorder actually affected his writing. But there's a generation of American artists like Norman Mailer who came back from the war and channeled cathartically their experiences into their art. There was film noir, which was a reflection of the jaded, cynical post-World War II world. And I believe all these influences coalesced, which gave Eisner's Spirit an entirely richer, deeper dimension as comic book noir on the page as never before. And Eisner would literally give us the worldview from the gutter in the Spirit, no different than what was happening in film noir at the same time in the 1940s. Look at how this classic image from Orson Welles' Citizen Kane is reflected a couple of years later in Eisner's beautiful Spirit page, 1948. Here's a piece of the original art with its yellowed paste-ups, but I chose this example because it highlights another feature that Eisner shares with film noir. And that's, of course, the femme fatale, modeled on the femme fatales of the cinematic world, Marlene Dietrich, you can see reflected in the many beautiful and deadly stars and starlets that peopled Eisner's spirit. Rita Hayworth, of course, was reflected in perhaps Eisner's most fatale of his femmes, Pagel. Or was it Pagel? I never knew what, you know, her name was, but she was a favorite of Eisner's, with maybe this being the most classic introduction of all. I am Pagel, and this is not a story for little boys. Which brings up, of course, Lauren Bacall and those eyes, which was totally captured in Eisner's vision of his femme fatale. And then, of course, there was that logo. And Eisner's post-war spirit logos are graphic brilliance, each one worth pondering for as long as you want to take in the magnificence of Eisner's work. Each and every one literally tells a story. Of course, you can see Eisner is both, you know, below the city, at street level. And the dimensional, literally three-dimensional depth that Eisner was playing with on the flat two-dimensional image were startling. I mean, you can feel the winter wind blowing the paper of the Spirit logo as what looks like the Cross Bronx Expressway, or the, one of those, goes off in a distance. I mean, just incredible graphic masterpieces. By the way, folks, I'm showing you a combination of all the different reprint eras of the Spirit, the original coloring, the black and white and gray tone reprints, other full color reprints that Eisner supervised throughout the entire publishing career of the characters. So they're all equally valid. But speaking of billowing paper and feeling the extrasensory perception of wind, of atmosphere that Eisner got like a great movie director, because this feels like the opening of a film. But you know, integrating his type into his image is something that was influenced the graffiti artists in the 60s and 70s. Many of them in the 21st century have discussed how Eisner's spirit and his integration of the logo with the urban environment that you can find in so many great Eisner spirit splashes. Typographically, the way he would work in the signage of the Spirit, literally the signage, with his beautiful typography. Excuse me. Eisner worked with a great letterer named Abe Kanigsen, who executed magnificently Eisner's designs. But again, Eisner achieves multi-sensory perception because you can feel, you can hear that rain as it trickles off of the signage. Eisner's splash pages, pun intended on this one, are like comic book illuminated manuscripts. Eisner consciously experimented with word and image in different graphic forms. I mean, look at this one. This is from June of 41. doing this kind of word picture equation. And again, playing around with the look of newspaper graphics, knowing that he was being inserted into a newspaper format. Okay, let's get it out of the way finally. What is this very caricatured Negro, as he would be called, or colored person in the 1940s? Now, this is his post-war spirit art, but of course, the character named Ebony White, yes, Ebony White, was Denny Colt, the civilian identity of the spirit, his taxi driver. He would tool the spirit around town. You know, the shadow had Shrekky, his cab driver, that would take him around Manhattan. But yes, Eisner indulges in the worst African-American stereotypes that you can imagine. And it pains me to have to show these terrible images, but we must remember that blackface was a tradition dating back to the mid-19th century, brought into the 20th century through the genre of the motion picture, especially with Al Jolson singing Mammy in The Jazz Singer. But all media had this horrible racial caricature of black people. I mean, this is Merry Melodies, this is Warner Brothers. Disney, you know, has some things in their background that they've stuck in a vault forever because they're racist caricatures. But Eisner did give Ebony a dignity, a respect, a worth in the way he protected and guarded and honored the spirit. And always would show his humanity, usually through his tears. I mean, as difficult as it is to look at these images, I mean, this is sheet music. This is how multimedia Eisner was, that he was able to get every little bug, a song that he created in print in the spirit, and actually get it sold and recorded. So music was a big part of the spirit in the sense of Eisner understood the musicality of comic art in the integration of its words and pictures. He was so conscious of this was a reading medium. People were hearing a soundtrack in their minds. And if Eisner could bring that out graphically, then in a sense, you're enhancing what the reader is already feeling. And Eisner was a master at it. Again, with Abe Kanigsen, his letterer, the spirit is also a primer on comic book sound effect lettering, but it's in the service of narrative. Just look at how these opening two panels, you can hear the tick-tock of that metronome in your mind as you read Eisner's typically gripping narrative. Look at how, when I show you this next image, you immediately know, without having to read a word of dialogue, exactly what that telephone ring in the night sounds like, in the way Eisner, the great hand letterer, makes the left side of the R in ring tattered, shredded, that gets across what is obviously the shriek of the telephone ringing when you least expect it in the middle of the night. That's a master cartoonist at work. That Eisner can make you feel artistically those hands atop stretching. I mean, and then you get down to the bottom of the page and you know what that sounds like. You know what that feels like. Look at how Eisner would build a page from scratch using verbal and visual elements of comic art so that you know and hear that lightning crash. You can hear the dripping of the rain, the clink clack of footsteps coming out of the rain indoors, the creak of the door. Everything about this sequence, because of all the television and movies you've seen of lightning crashing, you know what that panel feels like. And then the master film director knows when to use his lighting and cut to a close-up. Now, in black and white, this page is magnificent, of course. It was originally seen in color, like this. But, you know, I would say because of the film noir feeling, I think we all kind of prefer the black and white. But, you know, that's the way Eisner, he built pages like you build a house. In fact, he actually had a page as a house with the different floors representing the different tiers of a comic book page. I mean, there's a black and white with gray tones and the original color. I would say this page had to have been an influence on modern great comic artists from around the world, like Hugh Schwartz. This early cover for Art Spiegelman's Raw magazine in the early 80s. Even Eisner himself, late in his career, did a page like this, which also plays with the graphic idea of building your comic book page, like you're erecting a building and telling the stories on the stories of the building. This is something that the great Chris Ware, who's very clinical, diagrammatic artwork and storytelling style, belies such a deep humanity. I mean, you have to almost get past the clinical diagram-like quality of his work, but it's there. But again, anything these great artists have done in the modern era, you can find precedent in some way in Eisner's spirit work, whether it was buildings from, you know, this kind of view and angle, or tilting our camera up like the opening of a great film noir, which is why I prefer to show this image in its 1974 black and white gray tone reprint. And again, the way Eisner built a page in this story using all the elements, you know, when they talk about film on paper, folks, it's really about telling a story using the same comic book graphic angles and techniques that a film director has in film. That's why this panel feels like an intense close-up. This one image shows you Eisner's mastery of so many things, not the least of which is his perfect mesh of realism with cartooniness, that the character on the left is just as much of a cartoon as that is Eisner's beautifully realized study of how material in a situation like this would form in that space. And I mean, look at the delineation alone of the spirit's gloved hand. I mean, again, we can stare at an image like this for a long time, but suffice it to say, as we return to this beautiful page, you can see down below, again, Eisner's use of type to give the page and the experience a soundtrack. But it's his changing camera angles on the comic book page that give these seven-page spirit stories their cinematic feeling. I mean, look at Orson Welles and his cinematographer, Greg Toland, and Citizen Kane, doing both down shots, you know, bird's eye views, and coming up from underneath, which is what Eisner was doing with the spirit constantly. Just look at this four panel sequence and how Eisner changes from bird's eye to worm's eye to medium shot, depending on what the story he was telling. I mean, look at this one where, yes, he takes us in for easier reading and better understanding. The reader is invited to view the rest of the story from the inside of Henry's head, looking through his eyes. Okay, it might be a little heavy-handed, folks, but, you know, at about the same time, Hitchcock is teaming up with Salvador Dali in Spellbound and coming up with ideas at the end of the film, like this hand turning around in three dimensions. Of course, the very end, it becomes a model, and pointing right at the character, which becomes us in the movie theater. And of course, that gun goes off. But Eisner had the same power with his spirit sequences. He understood that each panel is a sliver of time. And he broke up the motion of time on the printed page in sequence. And this is why when they say comics are film on paper, well, Eisner's really the first comic book artist to really get that cinematic three-panel sequence. You know, years later in the early 50s over at Mad Magazine, which of course started out as a comic book satirizing other comic books and comic strips created by the great Harvey Kurtzman, a contemporary of Eisner's. He also created the first anti-war comics like Two-Fisted Tales and Frontline Combat. I mean, Kurtzman as a cartoonist himself, that cover really gets across the feeling of the war is hell, and yet it's also a masterclass in cartooning as well. But you can see that Kurtzman's storytelling really took advantage of that three panel, very cinematic sequence in perhaps his most famous war story, Big If, about a US GI in Korea who finds himself on the side of the road, a victim of shrapnel. And as he recounts his life in the first six pages, as it's dying out, he realizes if only he hadn't done this, if only he hadn't done that, he wouldn't have wound up on this road dying of shrapnel. You know, Kurtzman experimented with the graphic form of a comic book in the early 50s by making Mad look like a newspaper. But again, anything Kurtzman did, Eisner did first in the spirit when he knocks off Life magazine. I mean, this was the actual January 1951 issue of Life. And it was a couple of years later that Kurtzman would do his famous Mad magazine or Mad comic cover illustrated by Basil Warburton that flipped out the minds of who a decade later would become the great underground cartoonists like Robert Crumb and Art Spiegelman and Bill Griffith and that whole crew. It was this cover. But you can see that Kurtzman, like Eisner, subverted the form of the comic book. Look at the disclaimer down below. Mad cover design makes people think you are reading high class intellectual stuff instead of miserable junk. Well, again, Eisner did it first. He does an issue of The Spirit that looks like a primer. And, you know, I talk about The Spirit being a primer in the art of comic book storytelling, but there is Eisner telling a spirit story of Rat-Tat, the toy machine gun. I mean, this is a magnificent Harvey Kurtzman design, MAD number 21, circa 1953. But, you know, Eisner did this in 1948, which, of course, is the knockoff of what's been knocked off a million times since, the famous Charles Atlas insult that made a man out of Mac ad. One of Kurtzman's companion titles, Tales Designed to Carry an Impact, one of the last EC titles circa 1954, maybe even into 55, I forget the date of this issue, but behind that Jack Davis cover is one of maybe the greatest story by Bernard Krigstein. You can see his signature in the bottom of the first panel there. But it's probably the first pop culture use of the Holocaust written by the Jewish writers and editors, Al Feldstein and editor and publisher, But yes, the publisher of EC Comics and eventually Mad Magazine. Not Ginsburg, his original name is Ginsburg. Gaines, Bill Gaines, his father, Max Gaines, changed his name from Ginsburg. His father, Max Gaines, created the actual form of the comic book. But in the early 50s, Feldstein and Gaines are writing stories like this. The first mention of the Holocaust, I think, in American pop culture. And Bernard Krigstein is chosen to illustrate it. And it's considered his greatest story. He would later leave comics and become a painter and a teacher. But the story about a Holocaust survivor encountering the commandant from his concentration camp in the New York City subway. You can see how Krigstein is, page one, is experimenting with this idea of strobed multiple images telling a comic book story. On the last page, the commandant runs away from the Holocaust survivor, upper left panel, and falls into the oncoming train to his death. And this sequence alone has become an iconic Bernard Krigstein sequence, but you can see that clearly Eisner was doing it years before. And then, you know, two decades later in the mid 60s, you get this great comic book artist who takes all the lessons he learned from Eisner and incorporates them into his Marvel comics of the late 60s. That would be, of course, the great Jim Steranko in a promo photograph for Marvel Comics. They dubbed him the Caliph of Creativity. But it was because he was using what he learned from Eisner's spirit when he was a kid reading it in his Reading, Pennsylvania Sunday newspapers. He would put to work like this famous splash page from his 1969 trilogy of Captain America stories that is considered by aficionados as one of the greatest three-story arcs in Captain America's published career. But you could see that the drama of this panel, and again, that cinematic quality, is found in Eisner's greatest spirit splash pages. This one in particular shows you another of his oft-used graphic devices to tell the narrative, and that would be the index card, the file card as a comic book panel itself. Of course, the genre of the spirit, he was basically a private eye, a crime fighter, so to speak. But some of Eisner's greatest post-war spirit stories have this great graphic of the file card And Eisner, in this particular story, one of his many masterpieces, really gives you that three-dimensional feeling on the two-dimensional comic book page. And if this doesn't feel like a film noir on a page, you also get that very theatrical that he got from his father, the Yiddish scenic painter. Eisner always treated his graphics very conscious of a three-dimensional stage-like feeling. That's why great splash pages like this have a very three-dimensional feeling, even though it's only a flat two-dimensional drawing. This is, of course, influential two decades later when Steranko would do splash pages for Nick Fury, Agent of S.H.I.E.L.D., circa 1968. Or how about this Steranko S.H.I.E.L.D. splash page from 1968, in which he really does beautiful typography and gets across that legend feeling graphically. But yes, Eisner did it first. This is why Eisner was able to author comics and sequential art. This is why Eisner is the D.W. Griffith of comics. This is why Eisner can author graphic storytelling and visual narrative. And we haven't even talked about the stories themselves. I mean, Eisner could have made the Spirit just another kind of, quote, superhero. And yes, the Spirit was a hero and he acted heroically. But more often than not, it was his humanity. It was his vulnerability, both physically and mentally, that the greatest Spirit stories display. In fact, sometimes the Spirit really wasn't even in the story literally. He was a presence. He was literally a spirit. And in these stories, Eisner would focus on the everyman, the little guy, the average Joe. This story called 10 Minutes was the last 10 minutes in this petty hoodlum's life. Beautiful character study by Eisner. Again, this all comes from the tragedies and the triumphs, the small victories of the Yiddish theater as these immigrants coped with the past horrors that they left in Europe, the pogroms and the Christian persecution to come to the New World. And nowhere is this Yiddish kite more felt than in another one of Eisner's most famous stories, the story of Gerhard Schnabel. Now, if that doesn't sound like a character out of Sholom Aleichem, then, well, you get the drift. But yes, please, no laughter, as Eisner says. Back to the black and white pages with the gray tones, because I don't have the color pages. You can see that Schnabel's having a bad day. And he's fired. And again, look at the mixture of realism and cartooniness. You get the realistic environment, but with beautiful cartooning action, that the sock in the center of the page. And then you get this epic page where all he wants to do is fly. You see in the middle panel on the right, there's a big crowd below. They'll see me and I'll be famous. And then he actually takes the leap. And that bottom panel, one of Eisner's single greatest panels, is again a beautiful combination of realism and cartooning. Those buildings feel as realistic as any photography I've seen of the middle of Manhattan. And yet it's pure cartooning. Those are just lines on paper, folks, as Robert Crumb once said. But Eisner was all about feeling from a two-dimensional flat surface. So that when you turn the page and you got this page, you can feel Gerhard Schnabel reverting to his childhood and flying. By the way, one of the first also to experiment with the mixture of photography and comic art, and that would be Will Eisner, really before anybody else, I think, did it. And the use of the captions to get across the feeling of fluttering in the air. And yes, instead of falling, Gerhard Schnabel flew gracefully to Earth. But what happens in Eisner's Yiddish theater comedy slash tragedy? He gets shot in a flyby. And so, lifeless, Gerhard Schnabel fluttered earthward. But do not weep for Schnabel. Rather shed a tear for all mankind. For not one person in the entire crowd that watched his body being carted away knew or even suspected that on this day, Gerhard Schnabel had flown. The sentimentality that Eisner got from his Yiddish theater upbringing, he always did holiday stories, Halloween, Thanksgiving. Again, nice, beautiful display lettering. Burfo Seltzer, a little meta advertising down there. And then the big kahuna, of course, the Christmas spirit. Eisner always did a kind of a Christmas story, but this has to be his most epic. And I choose, rather than the original newsprint coloring, I'm going to go with the 1974 reprint in the Warren magazines. They had a color insert in the first couple of issues. And the great Richard Corbin, who was not only a great illustrator artist in his own right, but a great color artist. You can see that in his own work at the time. The beautiful modeling and the incredible rainbow palette. So he colored this reprint version and all about a European refugee scrounging to stay alive. And he comes across what, yeah, looks like Santa Claus there. By the way, the beautiful lettering is the most indicative of this illuminated manuscript feeling that Eisner ever achieved in the spirit. And you can see that the kid shares with our old Santa there. Boy, I wish we could take the time to read this entire story, but we must move on. But suffice to say, look at what happens midway through the story. He actually, sure, we can transfer your visa to him and the plane will make it in 15 hours, but never mind. Just so he's there by Christmas morning. And so while Joyce slept, a mighty plane carried him away and brought him to the faraway land of New York City and what absolutely looks like Brooklyn Heights. Or Eisner's cartooning of it, which is one of my favorite single Eisner illustrations. Again, the combination of realism with cartooning. And then he winds up at the spirit's home or Commissioner Dolan's house. And yes, that's Ebony talking in mock Negro dialect. What country? Wow, this is U.S. America, boy. Come on in and have yourself a time. It's 1946. Brings him inside. And now little Joy knew that Santa Claus had given him the biggest Christmas present in the world. A Merry Christmas. Come on, boy, that's my boss, the spirit, and Commissioner Dolan, and Ellen, and Pajel, and lots of our friends. Come on, I'll share my Christmas present with you. It's the biggest one I ever had. Oh, thank you just the same, but I've already had mine. And I think this is sort of a fitting way to show how Eisner kind of finished up the spirit. By 1952, he was looking for other fields to conquer graphically and to make a living, as comic books, he felt, were on the wane. And he was always a great businessman. He owned the rights to the spirit. But he ended up getting involved, believe it or not, with the Pentagon, because they did research and they found that their recruits learned weapon system maintenance better through the medium of comics, words and pictures, than through film strips, video television at the time, early, and this is in the early 50s. And Eisner gets the contract to do a monthly comic book, PS Magazine. And I'm sure this made him a very good living because he kept it up, I think, up into the late 60s. And, you know, it was literally teaching all of that weapons maintenance using the comic book form. And his mascots there, like this chick, I forget what her name is. I know she had a name. But look, this is from 1965. So that shows you that Eisner was still doing this as his primary source of income for him and his studio. I think there's even collections, beautiful hardcover reprints of this PS stuff if you're interested. But you can see the audience that Eisner was appealing to, very cheesecake. So let's jump ahead almost 10 years from this 1956 issue of PS to find an issue of Playboy magazine from October 65. Why is this issue significant, telling our Eisner spirit story? Well, it features an article called The Great Comic Book Heroes. And it's by, yes, Jules Pfeiffer. Now, why does Jules Pfeiffer figure in the saga of Will Eisner's spirit? Well, there's young Pfeiffer when he was Will Eisner's artistic assistant. You might know of Pfeiffer more from his later career as the great cartoonist, especially with his iconic dancer character, who he would use in his frequent comic strips. But he was a multi-talented Renaissance man, still is, Jules Pfeiffer. Really the only comic book artist to really break out of comic books and become a legitimate artistic celebrity in other mediums. Really, he might be the only one who's really done it. I mean, Carnal Knowledge isn't the only screenplay that he got produced in the 1960s and 70s. He's still doing great graphic novels in his inimitable style, Jules Pfeiffer. But back in the late 40s, when he's assisting Eisner, he's doing his own very pre-Peanuts type strip called Clifford, which ends up developing his sense of humor. By the late 50s, he's doing a syndicated strip called Sick, Sick, Sick. And this was a byword in the late 50s and early 60s, this idea of new post-war humor, Lenny Bruce, Mort Saul, and Jules Pfeiffer. This is a 1960 collection of his comics, 666, A Guide to Non-Confident Living. This is what would become the counterculture later on in the 60s. Now, at the same time Pfeiffer's doing this stuff, Roy Lichtenstein is the enfant terrible of the art world, written up in Time or Newsweek as being America's worst artist, and yet he's making a fortune putting pop art on the map. And because this, his most famous image from 1963 called the Image Duplicator, you can see was obviously taken from one of Jack Kirby's X-Men Magneto panels. But by 1965, at the height of pop art's original fame, Marvel Comics, for a couple months in mid 65, actually rebranded their comics as Pop Art Productions. So the confluence of all these comic book currents reached the editor of Playboy, and he commissioned Pfeiffer to write an article about the source of this pop art that was taking the New York art world by storm. And that's what this article was about that appears in the fall of 1965. And you can see that Pfeiffer concludes the article with a nice shot of that great spirit image that I used as my logo image for this webinar. And that article turned into the first true comic book history book about, as it says there in the subtitle, the origins and early adventures of the classic superheroes of the comic books in glorious color. Because this was the first book, it appeared in late 65 or early 66. But in addition to reprints, Marvel and DC in the mid 60s were not reprinting their golden age material, only material from the 50s. We had never seen the origins of Plastic Man or Captain America. And needless to say, for an entire generation, this was our first exposure to the spirit when Pfeiffer reprinted this particular story, which this wasn't when he was working for Eisner, but this must have affected him so much that it was the one spirit story he chose to reprint in the great comic book heroes. Man, I remember being an eight-year-old in 66, and in my elementary school, a buzz went around that there was a book about comics in the Fairlawn Public Library. And like going there to find hidden treasure, it was in the large stacks, even better. And finding Pfeiffer's book was a godsend and really influenced again an entire generation. And then the next spirit media resurrection would occur at around the same time Pfeiffer's book comes out. January 9th, 1966, a Sunday edition of the New York Herald Tribune. It's long gone, but it was one of New York's big papers, along with the New York Times and the News and the Post, the Herald Tribune, and they printed it on this weird sepia-toned paper. But that particular Sunday, they had a major story, the first mainstream New York City newspaper coverage of the burgeoning growth of young Marvel Comics, poised to challenge industry giant DC Comics with their superheroes with super problems. And this article is both famous and infamous, but I don't want to digress too much. But that same week of January 9th, this television show would debut. Yes, the Batman TV show on January 12th, the Wednesday, 1966. So the Herald Tribune decided to commission Will Eisner to resurrect the spirit in a 2 or 3 page feature in that issue, which was obviously a comic influenced issue. Here is the first page. Eisner working in those gray tones, which were printed in that kind of weird sepia tone. But it was all about the spirit trying to deal with modern city life and politics and what was happening. Big election at the time that year with Lindsay and the garbage strike and all these other things that were happening in 1965/66. But it was this event that happened in 66. The explosion of that TV show and the Batmania that would follow the rest of 1966. You know, there was Beatlemania, Bondmania, and then Batmania 3 years in a row in the mid-60s. And the explosion of that TV show so influenced so saturated the rest of the culture and obviously spurted comic book sales. So Eisner, remember, he owned the Spirit, cut a deal with Harvey Comics. And these are some promotional ads that he put together to promote the fact that the Spirit was coming back, not as a 12-cent comic of 36 pages or so, but no, as one of those 82-page or 72-page, 25-cent annuals. And I remember staring at this cover. I was an 8-year-old kid in the summer of 66. And I remember I didn't even open up the cover because I was such a superhero zombie trained by the great Marvel and DC comics that were coming out at the time that I didn't even open up the cover. I never saw what was inside, that Eisner did a brand new version of his origin story, or how my young artistic life might have been altered forever had I seen splash pages like this in all those great Spirit stories that they reprinted. Man, I remember looking at this cover going, I can't buy a comic book with a guy in a business suit wearing a hat. Oh, but man, had I only opened up the cover, I would have seen the magnificence of this famous splash page. That had to be an influence 20 years later. This was 48, because in the spring of 68, Steranko would give us one of his greatest single comic book covers of all time. And then abruptly in 1970, Steranko left the comic book field and he ended up doing a 2-volume set of tabloid size books, soft cover, called The History of Comics. This was the wraparound cover of volume one, which covered the early years of the golden age, the 1940s, Superman, Batman, the early superheroes, and beautifully designed, printed in black and white, like this black and white photograph of Steranko behind, or in front of, I should say, the wraparound cover to volume two, which came out in 1972. And if you've never read these, they're the best written histories of the golden age you're ever going to read. Steranko is a great prose writer, but look at who he decides to feature in volume two. A character, those of us who missed those Harvey reprints would be totally unfamiliar. And Steranko was able to get Eisner himself to do a special full-page illustration for this volume of the History of Comics. And there it is. And what does Steranko do after a couple of pages of prose? He reprints this particular story in its entirety. This, for many of us, was our introduction to the greatness of Will Eisner in his primer that the Spirit would eventually have for an entire new generation. I mean, Steranko himself was influenced by Eisner pages like that a couple of years earlier in 68 when he's doing these Nick Fury Agent of S.H.I.E.L.D. stories where every issue was a graphic beauty. But you can see his influence from Eisner. And that brings us this comic book guy, an underground comic book guy, into the picture, Dennis Kitchen. Dennis Kitchen in the 60s was one of the first generation of underground cartoonists, Crumb, Spiegelman, Bill Griffith, Dennis Kitchen. But he showed more entrepreneurial savvy as an editor and publisher. And by the early 70s, he's actually cutting a deal with Marvel Comics to try to bring underground comics overground. And that's when he met Eisner at a comic convention, I believe, in 1972. And Eisner was impressed by the underground comic scene of the late 60s and the entrepreneurial spirit. Because remember, Eisner was entrepreneurial. He owned the Spirit. And that's why Kitchen was able to cut a deal with Eisner in late 72. So in 1973, two comic book size reprint issues in black and white came out, again, reintroducing us after Steranko's tease with more stories of the Spirit. And he got Eisner to do wraparound covers of both issues. Here's an example of a new story that Eisner did, dated 72, just for that issue, and showing you how attitudes post-1960s towards criminals having their rights and everything else, I think you can glean Eisner's attitude about it through the Spirit in this one page. Here's the front cover to issue two. Again, I believe both were issued in 1973. Wraparound. At the same time, Eisner is teaching, literally, a new generation of comic artists in the 70s at New York City's School of Visual Arts. And you've got guys like Drew Friedman and Peter Baggy and Daniel Clowes and so many of the new generation of comic artists that attended School of Visual Arts. And at the end of every year, he would put together a comic book magazine size collection of the students' best strips. So again, Eisner, through teaching, brings in a new generation. And then Jim Warren of the black and white Warren comics comes along, possibly post about the same time that Kitchen is doing these reprints. Warren, who is, you know, the man behind the great black and white horror magazines since 1964, Creepy and Eerie. These are beautiful Richard Corbin covers. So in 1974, in the spring, we get our first of many years worth of magazine size, black and white with gray tone reprints of the Spirit stories that really bring the Spirit to a whole new generation. You can see where Basil Gogos, the cover painter, took his inspiration from Eisner's classic splash page for this painted cover. And on the insides, we would again be enthralled by every one of these great graphic, visual, artistic splash pages and the stories that followed. I mean, you can feel, if you've been in the New York subway, you can feel what that page feels like and sounds like, maybe even smells like. Always graphically experimenting with different planes and dimensions of the comic book page, of these great splash pages, giving reprint accreditation, you can see. Eisner then was doing new covers for the Warren magazines. This was his original painted version, but Richard Corbin got a hold of it, and that's the cover they ended up going with. I really like the kind of psychedelia of this coloring, which again, you can see from Corbin's own work. I mean, I love the pink cover of this new Eisner image from 1974, one of my single favorite Spirit images. Corbin also colored a couple of the early color reprints that Warren was experimenting with as single story inserts in the rest of the black and white magazine. And this particular story features just an incredible sequence in the rain. And you can see that Corbin could also be very minimalist in his coloring, which gives the second panel such dramatic impact. And then you get my single favorite Eisner Corbin panel in sharp focus there. Once again, the mixture of realism and cartooniness that Eisner in the early 70s shows he hadn't lost a step from what he had been doing in the 1940s. And that's why I think it was Harlan Ellison who said, you can feel the wetness of the rain on an Eisner spirit page. Well, into each life a little rain must fall. And many of us only found this out years later, but in the early 70s, Eisner and his wife, they had one daughter, a teenager, and she died, I think, at the age of 15 of leukemia, I believe. And this devastated Eisner and his wife. And I don't think he revealed her death only to a few close friends and relatives. But we in the comic book public did not know any of this. And that's why we didn't realize that a couple of years later, Eisner would cathartically channel that tragedy into this story. Because after all, this was the day Frimmy Hirsch buried Rachel, his daughter. This story features a rabbi coming home from burying his daughter. This is 1978. I would think 4 years or so after his daughter dies. And the rabbi has a monologue with God, very Job-like, in which he challenges God to keep his side of the agreement. Because if God requires that men honor their agreements, he felt his life as a rabbi was him honoring his agreement with God. Is not God also so obligated that he would take his loved daughter's life from him? Forces Frimmy Hirsch to enlist his lawyer friend Shloime Kreks to sign his name below that of Frimmy Hirsch, thereby entering into a contract with God. A contract with God would become the title of what is generally considered the first mainstream graphic novel in American publishing. Now, this is in a bit of a dispute with some other works, but suffice it to say, it was Eisner actually selling it to the publisher. It was William Norton, I believe, at first, that this is a graphic novel. And yet it really wasn't a graphic novel. It was a collection of short stories. But Eisner had the balls to call it a graphic novel right up front. And I think that's what really makes it the first graphic novel appearing in 78. Because he called it such, he claimed it. And starting with A Contract with God, this would be Eisner's career 2.0. And he begins churning out, and I don't use the word churning pejoratively, but Eisner produces graphic novel after graphic novel, almost one a year, if not maybe not that frequent, but it felt that way. And each one was a different genre, science fiction, war, even semi-autobiography when he does a Romana Clef on the history of comics called The Dreamer, billed as a graphic novella set during the dawn of comic books. And all during this time, he's reprinting The Spirit. After he works with Dennis Kitchen on a magazine, they turn it into a monthly full-color reprint comic. And this goes on for decades. And I believe it was in the 80s, the late 80s, that Eisner brings a long-desired multimedia version of The Spirit to life in the film. Now, I think it was just a TV movie. It wasn't a theatrical release film. And the actor to play the spirit, that would be Sam Jones. How do you know Sam Jones? Because he was Flash Gordon in that very campy 1980 Flash Gordon movie. And I found this little tidbit on the internet to give you some idea. This was some weird little promotional film that was made for the TV movie. Trust me, folks, it was as bad as that promo. I remember seeing it on television. And there's Eisner in his later years. You know, he never stopped doing the subjects that were close to his heart. Of course, that would be all of his Contract with God. I don't want to say spinoffs, but he would end up doing literally multiple graphic novelettes, I would call them. You can see New York, The Building, City People, Notebook, Invisible People. And then Eisner never left behind his Jewish background, the first American-born generation from immigrants from Europe. And in graphic novels like Minor Miracles, Family Matter, Eisner dealt with the Jewish values and ethics and morals. As an historian, he gave us a graphic novel giving us the kind of truth behind the Fagin stereotype used by Charles Dickens in Oliver Twist. Or did he write Oliver Twist? Whatever. But the last graphic novel that Eisner was working on, his last published work, was a graphic novel investigation into the truth behind the infamous anti-Semitic tract, The Protocols of the Elder of Zion. And it was while, I believe, finishing up work on it in 2005 when Eisner passed away. The memorial issue of Comic Book Artist magazine that appeared in 2006, you can see that the illustrator of Watchmen, Dave Gibbons, English illustrator, patterned his beautiful cover after the famous Eisner spirit splash that I used as the graphic for this webinar. I myself chose to use this, one of the greatest spirit logo images. I chose to use the Richard Corbin colored psychedelic version because I did a 4-page verbal visual eulogy for Eisner in which I combined a lot of the images that I've shown you tonight with my own descriptive text so that in 4 pages, you'd sort of see the sights, the sounds, the film on paper that is Eisner's The Spirit, a primer in the art of comic book storytelling. Since Eisner's death, he's been honored everywhere. This is from New York's Society of Illustrators. Perhaps his greatest legacy, in addition to the spirit and his body of graphic novels, is the fact that it's his name that are the Oscars of the comic book world. I actually had a hand in designing that logo. I know Jackie Estrada, the great administrator of the Eisner Awards. And I think she disagrees with me, but I remember her asking me in the early 90s to come up with an Eisner logo. And I remember giving her a sketch that looked like that. But needless to say, Eisner would lend his presence every year at San Diego to hand out to each of the winners in their categories the award named after him. He would lend his artwork every year to the comic convention. And then when he passed away, San Diego has not forgotten him and uses his name and image in their, you can see, very public promotion. Eisner and the Spirit have been honored around the world. This is a current exhibition in Cherbourg, France. You can see they use the image I showed you earlier tonight, as well as for their catalog that I believe you can purchase in a couple of weeks when they release it online. Of course, I guess it might be all in French, I'm not sure. But the exhibit itself, images were posted online just recently, so I was able to include them in this webinar. But man, what a gorgeously staged and hung exhibition that really gets across the three-dimensionality that I've been trying to stress in Eisner's art. I love the way they hang and enlarge some of Eisner's art, as well as show the actual original art, framed beautifully, exhibited beautifully. Nice type design. The underground rediscovery of Eisner. Remember, that's in the 1970s. That's when he does a contract with God. This is the curator's collection. Shows you how many times this classic has been reprinted in the last 40 plus years. Paul Levitz, the former publisher of DC Comics for a quarter of a century, just came out with this tome a few years ago, calling Will Eisner champion of the graphic novel. Look at this exhibit, part of that Cherbourg exhibit, focusing on the influence that Eisner had on Frank Miller's storytelling. This, of course, ties in with a book that came out over 10 years ago, I think, a collection of interviews, discussions, conversations that Miller had with Eisner over the years. Now, you know, Frank Miller, famously or infamously, right after Eisner dies in 05, jumps at the chance to direct and write his cinematic version of The Spirit. And man, he literally blew holes through the character. I don't know if you've seen the movie, but it was just as bad in as many ways as that 1988 television movie. When this early poster by Miller appeared, I knew that he didn't really get the spirit. The spirit was more than this barrel-chested private eye wearing a domino mask. This original art ended up being the cover of one of IDW's tabloid size artist editions, in which they reprint the original art in facsimile reproduction on the same paper, the same size, in full color, even though it's black and white. So you see all the white out, the yellowness of the paper. And they've put out a number of Spirit artist editions that really are gorgeous, because trust me, unless you're Jeff Bezos rich, you're never going to be able to afford the original art. These are the next best thing. DC Comics, which Eisner and Dennis Kitchen, his agent, brokered a deal with over a decade ago to be the sole licensee of his comic book works. And they've done a beautiful job in hardcover reproductions of the complete Will Eisner Spirit from 1940 to 1952. There's that image again that I love so much, and I was able to use Corbin's psychedelic color version in this double page spread of Steranko's work, showing his influence from Eisner, and the bottom right is from the great EC science fiction artist Wally Wood. They're all in my book, The Silver Age of Comic Book Art. The original edition came out in 2003. So when Eisner was still alive, he was in Tamarack, Florida, and my mother was retired at the time in Boca Raton. And I used to visit Eisner at his studio and got to know him somewhat on a personal level. I would see him up north at comic conventions and always say hello to him. And I took the chance and asked him to write me a blurb when the first edition of my book came out. And this is what he sent back to me via fax. Remember fax machines? But dear Arlen, here's the blurb you may use in connection with the book, The Silver Age of Comic Book Art. Arlen Schumer documents an important period in comic book history, told in an explosive format and stunning design. It reflects the kinetic rhythm of the era. Good luck, Will Eisner. I can't think of a better way to end this webinar by only hoping that I've done for Eisner's spirit tonight the same that Eisner did for me with this beautiful gesture that I'll always cherish. So thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for coming to the graphic greatness of Will Eisner's spirit. It's one of my many comic book history projects, whether they were live lectures, webinars. If you go to my website, arlenschumer.com, various subpages like my comic book history page, which is linked to my book buying page where I will sign and sketch in your personal hardcover. And yeah, you can buy it cheaper on Amazon, but come on, support your local artists and get a unique copy. I also run a Facebook group devoted to the Silver Age, as well as one just for Kirby's work and another for Neil Adams. Maybe my biggest influence forcing me to become an artist and an illustrator working in a comic book style, doing comic book art, but for advertising and editorial usage. And one of my specialties is turning people into superheroes and keeping a sort of photographic likeness. I'm also on the commercial site TeePublic with posters, t-shirts, and every tchotchke, gigaw, and thingamabob you could think of. Over 125 of my illustrations. And some of them that for copyright reasons didn't make the pass on TeePublic, I've got on my own commercial merchandise site linked from my website, popcultureman.com. Then there's my visual lectures and webinars. Visual lectures are what I used to call what I did live before the pandemic shutdown. You could see videos of many of them on my YouTube channel that's linked from my my website. But since the pandemic, I hooked up with a firm called the New York Adventure Club. If you go to nyadventureclub.com, I've been doing webinars for them that you have to actually pay for, but they're only $10. And even if you can't make it live, you can watch a recording of it for an entire week afterwards. But I believe I'm doing pop art, Roy Lichtenstein and pop art, and that will be on Monday next week at 7 p.m. So go to nyadventureclub.com. But on my own for free every Wednesday in June at 6 o'clock Eastern Standard Time, I'll be doing a webinar, Christ and Comics, showing the Christological nature of all the superheroes. For Jor-El so loved the earth, he gave his only begotten son with powers and abilities far beyond those of mortal men. New York Comics, the week after. And you can find information on these. Go to my website. There's an events blog. You'll be able to see all the information and links that you need. This one's about how New York City itself has practically been a character throughout the history of comics. I'm wrapping up my Connery Bond canon, the first four films webinar series, with Thunderball. I believe that's Wednesday, June 23rd. At 7 p.m. And then ending the month on June 30th, a Wednesday, I'll be doing the sixth of my Silver Age monthly webinar series. And it's a reprise of what I did last month because I screwed up the recording. So for everybody that missed the great Spider-Man, who did it better, Ditko or Romita? But again, just go to my events blog page of my website and you'll be able to click on all of my events and get their links and the information you need. So again, I thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for taking part in this webinar. I hope you enjoyed it, and I hope to see you on the next one. Bye-bye. Together we move like spirits
in the night. In the night. Thanks for attending this presentation. Hope you enjoyed it. And please remember to click the subscribe or follow button on your platform screen to be notified of all of my upcoming pop culture presentations. And visit my website, arlenschumer.com, to sign up for my newsletter, too. Until next time, I'm Arlen Schumer. Bye-bye.